This is chapter 4, the review problems. All right, so let's look at this first equation. This is really the beginning of what's called quantum mechanics. This was actually discovered by a guy named Max Planck. Anyhow, the E stands for energy. H is a constant of the universe called Planck's constant, and F is the frequency in Hertz. So the energy is got to be in units that we call joules. The frequency, of course, which we've encountered many times before already, is always in Hertz. And then H, this constant of the universe, is very, very small, but it's still, you know, this important constant of the universe. Is 6.63 times 10 to the minus 34th, and the units for H are joules times seconds. All right, so this equation originally just dealt with light. All right, so it turns out that this is the equation that first showed us that light acts as a particle, and in fact, this is, you know, sometimes you can think of this as the beginning of quantum mechanics, and you know, the idea of photons. All right, so there's a couple of other things that we should look at. Another thing is, so we can just remember, we already know this equation, right? So the speed of light is equal to the wavelength times the frequency. So if we rearrange that equation and we solve for the frequency, we get the following. Okay, so this is what happens. So if we solve this for the frequency, of course, is equal to the speed of light divided by the wavelength. All right, so well, that's fine, but see, here's the thing. In this equation, if I rearrange the frequency for the speed of light over the wavelength, then this equation for the energy of a photon, instead of being H times the frequency, which is fine, that's still true, this is just another form of that, is it becomes H times, instead of the frequency, it's going to be the speed of light divided by the wavelength. And see, this tells us, this particular equation tells us that that energy, so the energy and the wavelength are inversely related. In other words, as the wavelength gets smaller, right, like gamma radiation, which has the smallest wavelength, the energy increases enormously. As a matter of fact, it's the highest energy of any of the different forms of the electromagnetic spectrum. And then the reverse of that, of course, the opposite end, I guess, would be radio waves. Radio waves have the longest frequency, so this number becomes really large, and then, of course, the energy becomes very, very small. This quantity H times C, you know, we can use the value for H, 6.63 times 10 to the minus 34th, and if we multiply that times the speed of light, we get the following. So this is the value of H times C, the Planck's constant times the speed of light. Or this is one version of this. All right. So when we multiply, I guess I should write it out. So 6.63 times 10 to the minus 34th, and the units are joules times seconds. All right. So those are the units. And then C, of course, is 3. Times 10 to the 8th meters per second, and notice the seconds cancel, right? The seconds will cancel, and so so if you just multiply these two numbers, notice the units, of course, are joules times joules times meters, and that's going to become important for us. But if you just multiply the numbers, and I strongly suggest you try this in your calculator, you will get the following number, right? It's going to be, so this is going to be 1.989 times 10 to the minus 25th. And the units, of course, remember, after the seconds have canceled, the only thing left are joules times meters, right? So this turns out to be a, you know, this particular equation, if you know the wavelength, you can figure out the energy. If you know the energy, you could figure out the wavelength. So sometimes you're given a problem like the energy of a photon is a certain amount, so calculate the wavelength. Or if you know what the wavelength of a photon is, you could calculate the energy. All right, so that's and now that's one form. All right, so as I was saying, there's another way to write this, and sometimes it's much easier than using joules times meters. And there's another unit of energy. When you get down to the size of an electron, it's called an electron volt. It's basically the amount of energy that one electron, which has a charge of one, this number right here. I know it says joules right there, but that is actually 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19th. If you used units called coulombs, that would be the charge of an electron. Anyhow, if you take one electron charge, which it, again is 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19th coulombs, and you put that one electron, you put one volt across that electron, this is the amount of energy that electron will gain. And so this is called an electron volt. So 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19th joules is one electron volt. So if we use the units of, and you're going to see why this will make a lot of sense when we start doing problem one. And I know it's a lot to get, we haven't even gotten to problem one yet, but this little introduction will very much help. So one of the things that we do is we use H times C, and we put it in these units called electron volts, and it turns out it's easier to use nanometers as well as it's 1,240 electron volts times nanometers. Remember the last one that we did, and it's the same thing, right? It's exactly equivalent. Was 1.989 times 10 to the minus 25th. That's the 25th times 10 to the 25th joules times joules, which of course are units of energy, times meters. And there are times when you're going to want to use this, and then there are other times that you want to use this HC in the second form, in the electrons times nanometer form. All right, and we're about to see that. All right, so we're at problem one. The first one says, what if the wavelength of a photon is 450 nanometers, what is the energy? Right, that's this first part. And then part B, if you will, says, if the wavelength is 200 nanometers, that's supposed to be nanometers, what is the energy? And I'm gonna actually show you two different ways to do these problems. All right, so for part A, if you use the one, you know, where the energy, you know, the energy is equal to 1240 electron volts. Oh, and they want the answer in electron volts, by the way. Electron volts times nanometers. Right, so this is why remember that's what H times C is, you know, this Planck's constant times the speed of light in these particular units. See, this is the nice thing about this is if I put it in these units, 450 nanometers, See, the nanometers cancel, right? So you're already in the proper units, and the answer will come out in electron volts. And so when you take 1240 divided by 450, the answer comes out to be 2.76. All right, so let's do this. So it's 2.76 electron volts. All right, remember, those are perfectly good units of energy. Now, it becomes a little more complicated if you do it in the following way. All right, so it's you know, we can still do this, but we're going to use meters per second and the original Planck's constant in joules, right? The 6.63 times 10 to the minus 24th. All right, so when you multiply Planck's constant times the speed of light, you get a instead of, you know, the 1240 electron volts times nanometers, you get 1.989989 times 10 to the minus 25th. All right, we'll come with the same answer, but it'll take a little, you know, it'll take some conversions to the minus 25th. All right, that's getting a little close to this. This is a different problem, obviously. And that's joules times meters, right? And then we have to divide by, now the wavelength was given to us in nanometers, right? So if you remember your metric prefixes, I'll do this over here, 450, if we replace the nano by what it is, right? Nano means times 10 to the minus 9th, right? So I'm just going to replace this, the N, by times 10 to the minus 9th, right? Remember the metric prefixes. And so, of course, that's going to be meters, all right? The reason we have to have it in meters, here, let me write this down out here. So 450 times 10 to the minus 9th, meters, right? So now the meters cancel, and that'll give us an answer in joules, which we don't, you know, that's fine. We can convert joules to electron volts, right? And we'll get this number. We'll get 2.76 electron volts. All right. So anyhow, in joules, let's see, what does it come out to be? So you just take 1.989 times 10 to the minus 25th divided by 450 times 10 to the minus 9th, right? Because that's in nanometers. You get, let's see, where is it? There it is. 4.42 times 10 to the minus 19th joules. Right, but now we're going to convert that to electron volts, which of course our answer should come out to be 2.76, which of course, you know, this equation, this version of the equation, right, it's just different versions, requires almost a direct answer, where this one requires several conversions. Okay, so either way, you're going to get the same answer. All right, so continuing this problem, the energy turns out to be 4.42 times 10 to the minus 19th joules, and we want to convert that to electron volts. So the conversion is right here, so it's 1 electron volt equals 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19th joules. So I'm going to set up, remember, this is the answer that we should get, 2.76 electron volts. All right, so here we're going to use this conversion, and as we always do with conversions, we write our fraction. So we're going to have to cancel joules, so I'm going to put 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19th in the denominator, joules, of course, and then in the numerator we put 1 electron volt, 1 EV. All right, and the joules cancel nicely, and so this, when you divide 4.42 times 10 to the minus 19th divided by 1.6 6 times 10 to the minus 19th, you get